In 1964, after the success of his dark nuclear comedy, Dr. Strangelove, Stanley Kubrick began a major motion picture. It was to be a film about abstract scientific ideas, the origin and the future of the human species, life in the cosmos, the evolution of our machines and artificial intelligence. Even to this day, Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey remains the all-time great science fiction film. Its groundbreaking photographic techniques still influence modern special effects. But as our films get ever more spectacular, 2001 reminds us that it's the ideas behind the spectacle that are still the most important special effect of all.
Stanley wanted to create a myth, and I think he succeeded. A myth should contain all sorts of levels, and different people should have different interpretations, and that, of course, is exactly what's happened. I mean, there's a whole literature about the meaning of 2001. To make the proverbial good science fiction movie, implying that there hadn't been any good ones before then. I didn't agree with him. There had been some good ones, fantastic. Voyager was one. And I was rather fond of Things to Come, a version of H.G. Wells' book. And I got Stanley to see it, and he thought it was absolutely terrible, and of course it was very naive.
If it was science fiction to imagine a rocket being fired at the moon, the scientific facts of the early 1960s seemed even more unbelievable. America's first real rockets were blowing up on their launch pads, and the Soviet Union was dominating space. 90 minutes. How far ahead were they in the nuclear race? America was galvanized into action. President Kennedy commanded NASA with the promise of almost unlimited funds to achieve what seemed then an impossible task. Against this highly political backdrop, Kubrick and Clark set out, in their movie 2001, to predict the future of space exploration. His close connections with NASA gave Clark privileged access to the design and construction of real space hardware.
We're in the final assembly building of the LEM, the Lunar Excursion Module, which will take two American astronauts down to the surface of the moon. And in 2001, Stanley Kubrick and I have set ourselves several objectives. We hope to convey to the public the wonder and beauty and promise of the new age of exploration which is opening up before the human race. We want to convey the message that our Earth is perhaps not the only abode of life.
I was holed up in the Hotel Chelsea most of the time during the early stages. I went through my short stories and dug out six which seemed appropriate to our ideas, and I sold them all to Stanley. And one by one, he threw them away, and I bought them back, and they're still available. And Stanley decided that the best way to produce the film was to write a novel, or at least the outline of a novel, first. We finally settled on one short story, originally called The Sentinel, which is about the discovery of an artifact on the moon, which had been left there millions of years ago by some other civilization, and which I suggest was a kind of burglar alarm to trigger the news that we had escaped from our planetary cradle and were about to invade the universe.
His scouts reported back from the New York World's Fair that a short animated film from Canada employing stunning special effects might provide valuable inspiration. Two young American animators exhibiting their own work at the fair were also enjoyed.
Stanley, I'm not sure how he saw it, but he called us up because he had seen it and was interested in getting work done on a film he was going to make with Arthur Clarke.
I called Con. I said, Con, you know, what's with this Kubrick guy? You know, could I get a job on that movie or something? And he said, well, I'm under a confidentiality agreement, and I really can't do this. And then I called another friend of mine. He said, well, you know, Stanley's phone number is actually penciled on the corner of the bulletin board in the office. And if you found that, you could call him yourself. So I did that.
I had a phone call to say, would I be available to meet Mr. Kubrick? And so I went along to MGM to find Mr. Kubrick. And I was told he was around, and I had to look for him because he was always wandering around everywhere. So I walked onto the stage, and there was a painter on the stage. And I went up to him, and I said, I'm looking for Stanley Kubrick. You haven't seen him around, have you? And he said, I am Stanley Kubrick. And this man, dressed in a sort of disheveled blue suit and trousers, eating a sausage, half-eaten sausage, was Stanley Kubrick and not a painter.
He was incredibly cordial and friendly and helped me buy the airfare, and my wife and I moved to England virtually lock, stock, and barrel, intending to be there 9 months, ended up being there almost 3 years. They had beautiful models of their concepts for the weightlessness effects and the upside-down sets and rotating sets, and I was just blown away. I just thought this is some kind of nirvana.
Stanley, working with Arthur Clarke, wanted me to be the overall scientific advisor. Every element of the film, scientifically, technologically, looked at today, would have been my responsibility. Well, he wanted us to make certain that every detail was legitimate. He didn't know at the time where he was going to put his camera. So the geophysical instrumentation, the astronomical module, the chemical analysis module, the communications module, the hibernation module, all of these modules on the Discovery spaceship had to be exact and had to be realistic and had to be really approved by the best scientific knowledge that we had at the time.
We had to make a pen float in space close by William Sylvester, who was lying asleep in a seat. So we devised a rig, which was a large circular sheet of glass surrounded by steel and bearings so that we could rotate the sheet of glass. And then we had some double-sided tape, newly invented, and we put the pen on the with the double-sided tape on the glass, and then we rotated the glass so it floated in space.
Float out of his pocket and gradually make its way to the other end of the studio and have to be rescued from space, just to make people realize the problems of being in space.
The stewardess then was walking down the corridor between the seats, and she came up and grabbed hold of the pen and walked off. She had to use stiction, you know, to get rid of the stiction of the double-sided, so you can actually see her pull it off the glass if you look carefully.